And we're in a rather fancy hotel with Anthony Kiedis. How are you doing?
Fancy place, very ritzy.
It's good. I think a bed used to be here, because I think this might be the headboard.
I like the wallpaper.
I do too. It's lovely. Is it recessed? Oh, wait, it's a little bit soft. Lovely.
It's not the velvet you were looking
no,
for.
No. They've gone cheap. They've gone cheap. They've gone quick. Fresh from Paris, I do believe.
Not fresh, but yes, from Paris.
Okay, so you didn't enjoy your breakfast in Paris. You didn't enjoy a delicious Parisian breakfast.
I did, yeah.
But here.
Just, I don't feel fresh is what I'm saying.
Oh, yeah. Okay. You must be knackered.
Stale from Paris is what I am.
So what does an Anthony Kiedis morning look like?
I mean, oh, wow. It looks a lot like my 8-year-old son.
Right, okay.
Because he usually comes traipsing through the door with needs, wants, desires. He wants to play. Mm. He wants to talk Legos. He wants to talk Pokemon.
Okay.
And will we be watching something together, some sort of documentary. So I'm trying to feed myself, look at my schedule for the day, and then, you know, juggle the boy.
But do you get distracted by the television? Have you got a favorite Pokemon?
It's not. Pokemon defies my ability to comprehend.
Right, okay.
It's designed for the child's mind, and it just over my head.
You got a new album out. With this one, you actually said you wanted to get uncomfortable. What did you mean by that?
Did I say that?
I think you said
that. I'm going to live to regret that statement. No, it's true. It's true. Being in a band for so long and writing songs together for so many years and working with Rick over and over has been prolific and abundant and fun and prosperous and all that good stuff. But we were due for a change, and we felt like we needed to take ourselves out of the comfort zone and try something that would be a bit more challenging and maybe a different process. You know, different chemistry with an equally as qualified person as Brian Burton, who we didn't know so well, so it was scary. And, you know, he had an aversion to some of our songs and a love for some of our other songs, so that was a little off-putting. But then it also became something that we found a positive, because he wasn't afraid to tell us what he loved and what he disliked, which is a producer's job in some ways. And it turned out to be exactly what we needed, and we rolled the dice, and they came up looking good for us, because I like what he brought to the party.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How hard was it to walk away from Rick? Because obviously you guys have been working together for such a long time.
Well, I didn't look at like walking away. You know, he's my bro for life. Mm. I love that guy. He's part of the family. And I think he understood, you know, you go off and try something new. Mm. So there's a little bit of pain in the heart, because I knew that he would, for at least a day or two, go, huh? I thought we had a thing going on, but if you look at his schedule, you know,
he's busy enough, right?
He's too busy. And at this point, I think he's got a sacred arrangement with Kanye where maybe we wouldn't even totally fit into his world. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I mean, this time around, I guess you'd usually sort of jam songs out, wouldn't you? But this time around, you've had to be a bit more methodical when it comes to actually putting the songs down.
Mm.
Danger Mouse insisted on you kind of getting in the studio, and he's a little bit more hands-on, is it fair to say?
He's hands-on, yeah. He's hands-on and not afraid to speak his mind, and he wants to leave some kind of a mark where, you know, Rick is more about just bringing out who you are in that moment. Yeah, Brian likes to sort of, you know, get a foot in the band, if you will, and, you know, maybe tickle an ivory or two along the way.
Yeah.
It was fun. I mean, it was high pressure situation where we would go into the studio with nothing and he would say, Chad, give me a beat. I don't like that beat. Try again. You know, think Michael Jackson. And Chad would be like, think what? And then, but he would, and he would just sort of conjure up these moments of musical direction that would guide us into something dope. I mean, you know, Flea and Josh are wildly imaginative, and if you just give them a sentence of direction, the next thing you know, you're listening to music that you want to hear and music that I want to write to.
Yeah.
So then they would give this to me, and I would say, oh, when do I have to have this song by? And they'd be like, well, tomorrow's good. Or right now, if you want to just go improvise. So in that respect, it was new and challenging and sometimes really productive.
Yeah. Was there ever an opportunity? Because obviously Flea really badly hurt. He was really badly hurt. Was there ever a chance that you would be recording this album without him?
Without Flea?
Mm.
I don't think that happens.
Mm.
I don't think that that's a possibility.
Yeah.
We didn't know how bad he was hurt.
Yeah.
You know, there was a moment where like, will he be able to play bass again? Mm. Or maybe he'll just be you know, half the bass player that he used to be. And he worked so hard in his therapy and his recovery. I don't think he was going to settle for not being able to do his thing. And he worked hard and he got it back. And it turns out that that time was valuable for us, that downtime, that Flea hurt time.
How hard was it watching one of your best friends relearn his craft, his livelihood?
It was harder for him than it was for me to watch. So, yeah. I watched how hard it was for him. And I think he was terrified, you know, because he was all doped up for a little while. A very painful thing.
Yeah.
So he wasn't quite himself. And then I watched him, and I'm telling you, he really put his mind to getting back, and then some.
You guys have been, you know, bros forever, pretty much, since high school, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
How have you guys remained so tight? Because, you know, the trials and tribulations of being in a band for such a long time, it can tear relationships apart.
I can tell you this much, I have no idea. I honestly don't. That relationship has taken on a life of its own that I can't even begin to explain or comprehend. There's something brotherly about it, but there's also something on an astral plane that I just don't even understand how we can be so close and, you know, we go through times where we don't really like each other, times where we love each other, times where we just soon not see each other, times where I call him every day. It's just, it's a family affair that I don't quite get.
Yeah.
Yeah.
with Josh coming into the fold before the last album, I think it was, wasn't it? I've heard that he's given you a little bit more respect for a couple of songs that you didn't used to play live, like Aeroplane and Best Friends and stuff like that. Was that important, bringing someone in who perhaps wasn't from your generation?
We didn't really care about the generation. We weren't aiming for any particular generation. Josh actually never gives us trouble about playing old songs, which if I was him, I might say I'd rather play songs that we've written together.
Yeah.
He doesn't balk. Like, he kind of loves it.
Songs, though.
he's a fan of music. And he wasn't necessarily a rabid Red Hot Chili Peppers fan. I think he appreciated what we did along the way. But to him, it's just like, yeah, it's another song. Let's learn it and play it.
Yeah.
Whether it's one of our old songs or an old David Bowie song or whatever. He just likes to learn and play. And now that he's been in the band for two records, he is in a different place than he was when we made our first record. It's more his band now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you sometimes need a reminder that some of the songs that you've written perhaps don't belong to you anymore? They belong to the people now, and you might not enjoy playing some songs that you wrote back in the day, but because they're part of your fans' lives, you feel a responsibility to play them.
Yes, but I think we share ownership with the fans.
Okay,
I'll give them some ownership, but they're still our songs, and we might get tired of night after night playing the same song. But you're right, you know, there is a sort of a responsibility to give people a song that they may have in their heart that they want to hear live, and they've just driven whatever 480 kilometers and spent, you know, all of their summer earnings to go see a show. I'd rather play a song that wasn't as exciting for me, but I knew meant something to them, and then it in turn becomes cool for me as well, because I see what's happening energetically in the audience, and I'm like, this is fun.
You once said that you've never regretted writing any particular song because, you know, you always, it was in a point of time where you felt you had to write that song. Do you still agree with that a little bit?
I do, even more so today. I wouldn't mind writing four horrible songs if it got me to the fifth song that was really magical.
Okay.
It's okay. It's okay to fail. You know, you have to fail to get somewhere. You know, if you were afraid of failing, you would never try anything. And it's more important for me, even when my most vulnerable, to set out and go, I'm going to try this, and if it sucks, oh well. You know, the next one won't, because, you know, we've proven that every now and then we get it right.
One of the warm-up shows that you did, I think the first warm-up show you did for this tour, was the Bernie Sanders benefit, and fundraiser. And Chad had an amazing Bernie Sanders head on his drums.
Yeah.
He does do some lovely drum art, does Chad.
He's gotten into that now. He's got a good one right now. Keep an eye out for it.
It's all the heads.
It's our faces on the animals on the record cover, yeah.
It's so good.
I will stop in the middle of a show and just admire his drum head.
Does he sometimes not even announce that he's got it?
He doesn't. He doesn't.
He
lets us. He lets us stumble upon it. Yeah.
Amazing. That's fantastic. You covered Boy, of course, at the fundraiser itself, at the Bernie Sanders fundraiser. What does that man mean to you, or what did that man mean
David
to
Bowie.
You?
Mm. he still means as much to me as he always did. Mm. You know, I don't look at it like he's gone because he left everything behind. I loved him when I was a boy. I ran into his shows as a very young person in Hollywood. I won Iggy Pop show at the Whiskey A Go Go in 1973. And then I went and saw him on a Ziggy Stardust tour. He played an open amphitheater in LA. Again, I was just a kid. And he just found his way into my heart immediately. I was so taken with his art and his beauty and his presentation and his sound. And it's like a wizard. Mm. He's like a wizard who just instantly casts a spell on you. And I never lost it, you know, all through my teenage years and young 20s, I could turn to his music for inspiration in life. Mm. And, you know, if I wanted to feel high on art and color and sound and just a dude with a vivid imagination, I could turn to him. And that never went away. And he never stopped being himself the whole time as an artist. It was pretty miraculous. And he's also a very kind, humble dude. Mm. So you saw him in Extras.
Yes, with this funny little fat man.
Yeah, just the guy was on it forever, and he always will be, and God bless him.
Finally, for now, speaking about the Bernie Sanders and the whole political discourse in your country with greatest respect, are you a little bit disappointed with this kind of anti-intellectualism that you have to deal with on Fox News and beyond?
It's disgusting, you know. Disappointed in anti-intellectualism always, wherever. You know, it's nice when people... and also I'm just sick of seeing his ugly face on the news. I can't stand to see him. It's been a very peculiar political year for us as a country. Not our most shining moment.
No.
But you know, that's the nature of politics. It's pretty much BS anyways, and they've just kind of taken off the masks to reveal the true bullshit that politics is. And you know, fortunately, the world continues to turn with or without horrific politicians. So I'm just hoping they can't mess it up for people.
You just look to the people, don't you, for a sense of normalcy?
Yeah, you look to the people because you're not going to get it from those guys. they don't care about anything but their world of money and power. So let's look to each other.
Let's look to each other indeed. Yeah. Thank you for joining me, Anthony.
Pleasure.
Have a great day.
Cheers.